lonely up here without Bob. Alone on the throne.
Dressed down, no socks. Dressed down, no socks.
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear
you. You dressed down, no socks.
Yeah, I didn't think he'd be here, so, but he met me outside. He didn't look down, though. Those socks are too much. I'm going to have to give him his shirt back because I don't wear it. It's too wild for me. I'm not qualified for that. He's wearing my shirt I gave him last year, but I couldn't wear his. It's just, I'm just not that free. What can I tell you? Oh, thank you. Yeah, maybe when I'm 400. Hey, you know, I know that there are some people who kind of don't get Bob. They have a kind of allergic reaction. I don't understand it, you know. Every word that comes out of his mouth is like nectar to me. I could just listen to him talk forever. So extraordinary. When he was reading that text, the Manjushri Nama Sangiti, the names of Manjushri, he knows what every word means, and he's emotionally, spiritually connected to the meanings of when he was saying, like, he said, and his mouth, the word bring, from his mouth comes sweetness. And he looked at me like, you know? And he feels it. It's just so rare. I mean, scholars don't, you know, he's not only a scholar, he's a practitioner. What's going on with the sound, dude?
It's the lavalier.
It's just a lavalier.
There it is.
Yeah. It's just the lavalier. Okay. Should I move it? Should I chew on it? What should I do? Just a little echoey, eh? What do you think? Should I put it on my nose?
Yeah, on your ear.
Okay, I won't move. Can't move, but I will. Anyway, so, anybody got anything to say? I don't. Okay, with the mic, we need the mic. Where's the mic? You got the mic? Right here. Keep walking. Raise your hand. There it is. Thank you.
How do you know if your human guru is Satguru?
You ever fall in love? How'd you know?
No.
You know.
What if something happens and you get separated?
You ever get separated? Seriously, you know. It's a knowing thing, you just know. And because Westerners are so needy and so emotionally, let me look for the right word, fucked up. We give ourselves away. We can't give ourselves away fast enough.
Krishna, I'm sorry, it's hard to hear you.
It's hard to hear me.
You want to just change the mic.
So okay, change the mic. We can change the mic.
But I
can't stop. So we're willing to give ourselves away. Anybody who pat us on the head, tell us we're good little boys and girls, and show us a little bit of affection, even if it's fake, we'll take it. And that's why we have these issues about gurus. It's not the fault of the guru, the real guru, because the real guru doesn't want anything from us, doesn't take anything from us. Is only here because we need to see it, to see the real thing, out of compassion for us. They're not doing business. They don't need you to be there even physically. It's just a different thing. And but when the teachings come here, and it's not just in the West. Also, the same thing happens in India. And everywhere, in every culture, there are fake, there are jerks acting like gurus. And that's just the way it is. And some people get very hurt by that, and some people get destroyed by it. But I've spoken to a lot of people who've been involved with a so-called teacher, and then find out, are those kids still here?
Yes.
Close their ears. Okay, I'll keep it okay. Doing weird, bad things, gurus doing, teachers doing bad things. But, you know, a real guru isn't advertising. It's just the whole of the ballgame. And you may think you found a guru in physical form, which, by the way, is not necessary. And then you find out that he's just a jerk or she's just a jerk, right? And then your heart's broken.
Or not that extreme. It doesn't need to be one extreme. Doesn't need to be one extreme or the other, right? It could be a combination of, right, because life is full of weird complexities, and right, so it doesn't have to be total or total jerk, I don't think.
For what to happen? What are you saying?
No, I mean, for some truth and valuable teaching to be conveyed.
Yeah, teachings can be conveyed.
Yeah.
But.
And I don't just mean intellectually. I don't mean that.
Yeah. There are a lot of techniques that can help us. Teachings can help us. Help us understand things. It's not on yet, but it's really not about that. It's about the love, the connection, and the knowing. The whole spiritual path, in my opinion, and like Bernie Glassman, who's a Zen master. Oh, very good. He used to talk about the Four Noble Opinions. You know, they talk about the Four Noble Truths, but he called them the Four Noble Opinions. So because if it's truth, you know, you can't, there's nothing to discuss. But if it's an opinion, then we can, you know, get into it. He was just great. So, yeah, the whole path, in my opinion, is learning how to trust ourselves. Nothing else is required at all. No techniques, no knowledge, no learning, no austerities, no meditation, nothing. Just learning how to trust oneself is all we need. But we are not trained like that in this culture to start with. So how are we going to even learn that? Well, after you hit the wall at about 100 miles an hour,
through dealing with your own life circumstances.
Yeah, for sure.
It's life is the ultimate teacher.
Exactly. If you're paying attention. If you have the karmas to be interested enough to pay attention. Otherwise, life just sucks, and people suffer for no reason other than to burn off more karma and make more karma. So that's, yeah. Yeah.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi. Thank you for being here.
I'm working on it.
My question is, have you ever had, whether like in day-to-day life or in dreams, had any visitations from Ram Dass or Maharaji?
Many. Ram Dass... Well, so, you know, Ram Dass and I were very close for many, many years. And a lot of those years, our relationship was very strained. But after the stroke, we got very, very close. But then he left the body, and I was okay with that. But, you know, I missed him. And then about a year after he left the body, I had this dream. And I came to some place where a retreat was being given. And I was greeted by somebody, and I said, well, where's Ram Dass? And he said, oh, he's sitting over there looking out at the mountain. And there were a row of chairs with their backs towards where I was. And then, so I walked over there, and there he was, sitting in the chair looking out the mountain. And I came up to him, and I forget whether we hugged or not, but he just looked at me and he said, I know you love me. There was something left, some little karmic dust. And that just whoosh, gone. Okay. It was too good. And Maharaji, not that often, but he shows up, you know, in that form quite a lot sometimes. But, you know, I would jump into boiling oil if it meant I could see that form again. But that's not the most important thing for me anymore, he said. And if you believe that, I'll sell you the Brooklyn Bridge. No, I mean, you know, that form is still my deity, really. You know, that's my... Once I met this yogini who I was madly in love with, this Indian woman. Her spiritual practice, she lived in Vrindavan, in Krishna's place, and her spiritual practice was to dress herself as a gopi for Krishna, you know, like makeup and hair and beautiful saris and jewels. And when I saw her, I lost my mind, you know. And I tracked her down in Vrindavan, and I banged on the door. And she had this swami who, this woman apparently used to go in these very deep, high states. And this swami was the only one who could bring her back into her body. So I was totally jealous of this guy. I wanted to kill him. And he wouldn't let me in, you know, to see her. So I kept coming back, and finally she agreed to see me. And I come in the room, and she's sitting on this couch, and she's just like, oh my God, you know. So she said, I'm only seeing you because of the light the guru put around your head. I said, okay. And she said, who's your Ishtadeva, who's who do you worship, essentially? I said, well, all I have is my guru. And she said, oh, that's very good. Because you know what he looks like. You know, we talk about all the deities and great beings, but we haven't seen them physically. But I saw Maharaji with my own eyes. And so it's easy for me to think of him and not doubt it. Because a lot of times when we do practices and we're not, and there's something we learned, we don't really trust the experience deeply enough. But it happens. The trust does come as our experience deepens. But I was just lucky that way. But yeah. So but I wouldn't, what I went through after he left the body, I wouldn't wish on my worst enemy. Probably. Yeah, I wouldn't. It was not good. Not fun. But I had to burn off a lot of stuff. stuff for a long time. I didn't start singing to people for 21 years after he died. 21 years. Right? Stubborn. You left me? Well. All right? So, 21 years. And then I only started because he came back to me and he said, essentially, he hit me with a thunderbolt. And I knew at that moment that if I did not sing with people, I would stay locked up in my dark little world. And I would never be able to clean out the shadows in my own heart. So I was screwed. It was either sing or sink. So it took me a while to get with the program. But was that? I was 26, 27, 26, 27, yeah, around that, something like that. So I was with him for essentially close to 3 years, 23 to 26. Till he sent me back. He kept me in India. He let me stay. He actually, one time I was in Allahabad at Dada Mukherjee's house. Dada's written two wonderful books about Maharaji. One is called By His Grace, and the other is called The Near and the Dear. And so when we were in Allahabad at Dada's house, we heard there was an Indian visa official in New Delhi who could be paid off to stamp your passport and let you stay. So everybody went. All the Westerners that were there went, pretty much all of them, went to Delhi. They didn't even say goodbye to Maharaji. They just went to Delhi. They figured they'd get the passport stamped and be back in a day, right? They all got sent home. And there I was, and I had to go to this town called Bodh Gaya because that's where I got my first extension. So I had to go back there. So one night I brought all my stuff to the house and I said to Dada, I said, you know, Dada, tonight I'm going to take the train to Gaya to try to get my passport stamped, my visa. And I said, but I'm not leaving without seeing Maharaji. So I waited for a while. So later on, I get called into the room and he said, what are you doing? I said, I'm leaving. I'm going to Gaya to get my visa extended. And he said, okay, so go. Jiao. I said, well, they'll probably send me back to America. So go. Jiao. Go. I said, that's okay. I know you're anywhere, everywhere. Ah, get out of here. Go. So I go back out on the porch, and I still had to wait a couple of hours till I got to the train. And so as I'm waiting there, Dada comes out and says, Maharaji said, don't go. He'll send you to his devotee, who's the chief of police in Kanpur, and he'll stamp your passport. Yeah. So for the next week, all Maharaji did was say, look, Ram Dass and others, they went to the highest level and they all got sent back. And Krishna is so humble and so good. And he just went to the lowest level and he got to stay. You know, total bullshit, right? But he kept on going on, oh, Ram Dass and others, and they all. Of course, it's nonsense. I would have gone, but I couldn't because I had to go the other place. I'd been in India longer than them. 6 months longer. So this feeling of trust is such a big thing. I think we don't really trust very easily, you know? But whether you have a physical guru or you don't have a physical guru, or you know who your guru is or you don't know who you, it's this feeling of trusting the universe to unfold in a way that's best for us, which is a concept that's completely opposite to everything you read in the papers, everything you learn in school and growing up. Trusting that what unfolds in our lives is ultimately for our own benefit, our deepest benefit, even if it's not, it doesn't look that way. There was a couple from New York who was kind of the, among the earliest 7 or 8 people, who, Westerners, who came to see Maharaji after meeting Ram Dass, Ed and Chris. And this is a story I wanted to put in my book, Chance of a Lifetime, but the editor kept taking it out. I kept rewriting it and putting it in, and she kept taking it out. And finally, I realized that she was taking it out because she couldn't understand the story. And I finally said to myself, well, if I can't tell it in a way that she can grok it, whether it's intellectually or whatever, then I probably should take it out. So I took it out. So the story is a very beautiful story in its way. It's very poignant. So, you know, like you might have, Maharaji was always on a regular basis telling people to go away. He used to say, go away is my mantra. Jao is my mantra. You've come? Good. Now go. So, because he didn't need us to be there, but if we got there, whatever reason, okay, now go. You're here? Okay, go. So, one of those times he jowed us, sent us away. Ed and Chris actually went back to America. They kind of felt that they'd been sent away. Okay, but before that, they asked Maharaji to marry them. And he looked at them and he said, No, I won't marry you. He'll marry you. He pointed to me. So, okay. So the next day we stood out in front of the Hanuman Temple and I read from the Bible or something like that. And I mean, okay, you're married. Good. Okay. So shortly after that they left. And then I didn't see either one of them for many, many years. And then I found out that Chris, who had been given the name Sunanda, had been fighting ovarian cancer for years, and she had been done all these treatments. She'd had another kid with her second husband, and bee stings and all kinds of therapies, everything. And she was still very ill. And Ed, who'd been given the name Sudama, which is the name of Krishna's boyhood friend, was so ill that he needed a heart and lung transplant. He couldn't breathe. Nothing was working. So we had met a young Baba who we liked a lot, and we brought him to America. This is in the 90s? Could have been the 90s. Might have been the 80s. Yeah, it was either late 80s, early 90s. And so we got to the house where he was going to stay, and when he got there, he heard about Sudama being sick. And so he looked at me and said, tomorrow we're going to go there first thing. So in the morning, we drove to Queens, and we told Sudama we were coming. Knocked on the door. It took him 20 minutes to get to the door. He had to crawl on the floor. And he opens the door, and we go in, and Baba sat on this couch, and me and Sudama sat on the floor, and he asked us to sing Hanuman Chalisa. So I sang Hanuman Chalisa, and Sudama was mouthing the words because he couldn't make any sound and didn't have enough air. And so so shortly after that, Baba and I left. And later that night, Sudama called me, and he thanked me for coming and thanked me for bringing the Baba. And he said he felt like Maharaji had come back to him after so many years. And he was really happy. And in the morning, he was dead. So Maharaji named him Sudama. Now, the story of Sudama is like this. Krishna and Sudama were boyhood friends, and they were out with the cows. And they were hiding from a rainstorm in a tree. And they fell asleep in the tree. And when Sudama woke up and was hungry, and so he ate his lunch, and he was still hungry, so he kind of reached over and ate Krishna's lunch. Not a good idea. You don't eat God's lunch without asking him, you know. So as a result of that action, Krishna never said anything. He woke up, he didn't say anything. But as a result of that karmic action, when he got older, Sudama grew, he was blind and poor. And he was living in the village, the town where Krishna was now king. And Sudama's wife was ragging on him all the time. Come on, Krishna's your friend and he's a king. You should go. We'll ask him to help us. You know, he'll help us. But Sudama was too embarrassed. And he just kept refusing to go. Finally, his wife puts some parched rice in a cloth, hands it to him, and kicks him out of the house and said, don't come back until you've seen Krishna and ask for help. So Sudama, as a blind man, made his way to the town and to the palace. And he sits outside with the other beggars. He doesn't even announce himself to Krishna. He just sits outside with the other beggars. And at some point, Krishna comes out and he sees Sudama and he goes, Sudama, I can't believe it. You're here. This is so great. Come on in. And he shows him around. Did you bring anything for me? Did you bring anything for me from our village? Come on. And Sudama's not showing. He's not saying. And Krishna's, come on, you must have brought something. And he goes, oh my, you brought up rice like we used to eat when we were kids. This is the poorest thing you could possibly have. But I can't believe it. And he eats it all up. And then he says, I'm a king now. I have to do all this nonsense. So you should leave now. But please come back anytime. Come back and be. So Sudama leaves and he makes his way back home. And he's being blind. He knows the way, just by intuition already. He's done it so many times. So he gets to his lane and where he's feeling along this. And instead of this rickety old fence, there was this solid thing. And he's going, what's going on here? I know I'm in the right place, but this is not. And he keeps working his way along this path. And he gets to the place where the gate to his little hut was. And now there's this solid metal thing there. And he's just so confused. He's standing there. And his wife and kids come running out and they say, look what Krishna did. You must have asked him for help and he's turned our place into a palace. Right? When Maharaji did not marry them, he was allowing whatever karmas had to come to fruition, and he could have changed that. He could have interfered. He could have lightened it. He could have changed it. But who knows what he did do? Because they lived through it ultimately. He was allowing those karmas to run out, and he was allowing them to burn off what they had to burn off. And I'm sure that he probably threw a shitload of other stuff in there to lighten their burden in future lives. But that was the moment he let that happen. And then, just like Sudama in the story with Krishna, at the end, his house was turned to a palace. Also, Sudama had called me on the phone and said, I feel like Maharaji came back to me, finally. And then he was gone. But this was doing by not doing. But I couldn't explain it to the editor, and she just didn't get it. So it's not in the book.
That was the story she kept taking out of the book. Yeah.
It was taken out of the book. Thank you. did something. Doesn't recognize me. It's like I'm somebody else. Ah, that's because I had a birthday. So, another word for trust is surrender. And surrender is not like a war where you surrender when you're beaten. It's not a power trip. It's the recognition of the way things really are. And for us, we basically have absolutely no control over what happens to us. Stuff happens in our lives. We don't get a vote. The one place we can possibly get a vote is in the present moment. How we react to what happens in our lives. So, Ramana Maharshi was one of the greatest saints that ever lived, that we know about. And this is kind of what he says about a couple of things. Place your burden at the feet of the Lord of the universe, who accomplishes everything. Remain all the time steadfast in the heart, in true being. God knows the past, present and future. He will determine the work, the future for you, and accomplish the work. What is to be done will be done at the proper time. Don't worry. Abide in the heart and surrender your acts to the divine. Like Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, you do what you do, but the fruit, the results of your actions are up to me. In other words, it's pretty clear. Whatever we do, but we can't make things happen. You can plant a seed, but whether it grows or not, no matter. Even if we stand and look over it, give it the best fertilizer, water it, everything, whether it grows is not up to us. And that's the same with karmic seeds as well. And then people ask me a lot, do I ever have any doubts? And there's two. The first answer is I never have any doubt about Maharaji. The only doubts I have about me. How many times can I screw this up? But I don't doubt who he is, who I know him to be. So that's a type of surrender. That's a beginning of surrender of some kind. And then also Ramana Maharshi wrote this. He said, surrender to him and abide by his will, whether he appears or vanishes. Await his pleasure. If you ask him to do as you please, it is not surrender, but a command to him. You cannot have him obey you and yet think that you have surrendered. He knows what is best and when and how to do it. Leave everything to him. His is the burden. You no longer have any cares. All your cares are his. Such is surrender. This is devotion. So, surrender is the goal. It's what we're working on, dropping our egos, dropping our delusion of that we're a separate being. And that comes through intuition, through understanding from within. It doesn't come from learning. It doesn't come from imagining, and it doesn't come from the use of our own personal will, except for the fact that we need a little bit of will to calm the mind a little bit. Because the clouds are covering up the beauty of the sunlight, and we need to find a way to release those clouds. And that's what practice is about. And Ramana Maharshi used the word he, but she is just as accurate. Of course. Like Bob said, every time the gods got in trouble, they called on Durga to help them out. Because it's a whole other level of being. Yeah, Mike over there. Okay, and then behind you next. Go ahead.
You talked about LSD before as far as experience.
A little closer, please.
You talked about LSD as far as an experience that, you know, was something I think important to you and to Ramda. I'm just curious, in this time and with your hindsight of the experience, do you see a role for psychedelics to accelerate or open pathways for spiritual growth? And I know it can be misused, but I'm just curious if you have any thoughts around that.
Well, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for peyote. I was a Long Island kid playing basketball and hating high school, and I took peyote between 11th and 12th grade. And here we are. Without peyote, I might have wound up a basketball coach at some elementary school in upstate New York. That's probably where I was going.
Thank you, peyote.
Thanks to peyote, yeah. Mm-hmm. But Maharaji was very clear about that. The yogi medicine brings you into the room with Christ, but you can't stay. The only way to stay is love. What more do you want to know? He didn't say it was bad. He didn't say it was a problem. But it all depends on what a person wants. If you don't mind, you know, the up and the down and the up and the down and the up and the down. So you can just keep taking it. But at some point, you might get tired of that, and you want to stay in the room. Yogi medicine won't do that. None of them. No medicine, no poison, no external. And nothing external can keep you in the room. So. But, you know, visiting ain't that bad. But one thing about those chemicals and those plants, in my opinion, is that if you do it too often, it will destroy your will, your ability to take care of yourself and to move yourself where you want to be, to get the things you want in life, to live in a good way, it can make that very difficult. Because you just don't want to be here, you want to be there. But the room where Christ lives is everywhere. It's not somewhere, it's not one little place. It's here or there. So that's the problem. It's an analog experience. You know you've taken a chemical or a plant. So the ego is not destroyed. It feels like it is, but it isn't. Got any? Last time I said that, 2 days later, somebody handed me a dose. Huh?
In this space, there's experiences where people do in-group ceremony.
Yeah.
I wonder about the power that it would be in the chanting that you bring forward. I travel across the border, so I don't have anything.
Okay.
And I'd be very careful. But,
yeah. Yeah, no, it could be a wonderful experience. No question about it. It's not I never had a problem. Some people had unhappy experiences, but my theory is that they didn't take enough. I took 1,000 micrograms of Sandoz acid. That's how, and I needed that to get out of the atmosphere, because my atmosphere was so heavy and so dark and so unhappy that in order to get through that, I needed enough propulsion. And that's what I would just play. I played with my dog for like 2 days in the snow, you know. And then there was a knock on the door early in the morning. I got out of bed, I opened the door, and it's the basketball coach. And the team bus is there in the driveway. They're on their way to a game, and I was supposed to meet them at the school. I'd been up for 2 days. I couldn't even see my body. And now I have to go play basketball. That was fun. And by the way, the guy I got the acid from in college had also been in my high school. We'd gone to the same college. And I scored 10 little beautiful turquoise blue capsules of 1,000 micrograms of pure LSD from Sandoz, which is the company that created it. And I didn't see that guy again for 50 years. I saw him at my 50th high school reunion. And I went right up to him and I said, "Hey, man, that acid I got from you, remember? I took the first one. I was in school. I had a job. I was playing basketball. By the 10th hit, I was on my way to India." And he said the best thing I've ever heard. He said, "Really? I took 1,000 hits and never got off of Long Island." Unbelievable. So it's all karmic, actually, you know. And he's still been on Long Island. And his brother-in-law is sitting over there. There he is. Yeah, applause. So, yeah, behind you. Yeah. Hi.
Hi. I'm actually here because I did acid at 15.
13?
15.
Ah, 15.
And he asked the question I was going to ask yesterday about acid. My question is this. It has to do with formulating, as I think, or speak, is surrender and desire. So, like in your example, you had darkness, you took an acid trip, and did you have a desire to get rid of the darkness, or were you surrendering to something? To follow the path, do you distinct it as a desire, like an intention? I do not want to be in this darkness anymore.
Well, certainly I had that. I wanted to get out of, I didn't want to suffer anymore.
So how does that work with surrendering desire? You also, again, you did not leave, right? You did not want to leave.
Leave where?
India. When they left you.
Yeah, no. Yeah, I didn't want to leave.
But did he tell you to leave?
Yeah, he sent me home.
So you stayed.
I stayed another year.
So my question is that surrender or desire from you?
We're human beings. We're emotional beings. We're physical beings. We're mental beings. And we have desires. It's natural. Those are natural things, for the most part. Those desires, they arise from us being incarnated in a way we are. The surrender part of it would come on the backside. Whether the desire is fulfilled in the way you want it to be, when you want it to be, and how you want it to be, that's where you can loosen up your egoistic, obsessive, grasping when it's talking about it. So you may have a desire for a Lamborghini. right? And all day long you're thinking about it, you can't get it, you don't have enough money, your neighbor has three of them, you know? And so surrender, the surrender or acceptance of the situation as it is means allowing that desire to exist. You can't kill it. It's not going to go away necessarily. I don't believe, nor did Maharaji apparently believe in that kind of killing the desire. But we're not required to act out those desires in certain all the time in every way. For instance, you might see that if you kill the neighbor next door and steal his car, you'll spend the rest of your life in jail. Okay, so that's not so much fun. Even if you get to drive the car for a week. So that won't work. And so you think about it, well, there's no way I can get a Lamborghini this life. Now, if you don't surrender to the situation as it is, and recognize that you're not going to be able to satisfy that desire, you'll suffer. You'll hurt. And that hurt will do a lot of damage in your life. It'll make you feel depressed and unhappy and you're not enough and you can't get what you want and that kind of thing. So that's one level of surrender. And that doesn't depend on you having a guru that you trust. It just depends on you being able to be present in your own life and be aware of what's going on, all the different aspects of things that are going on, instead of being pushed around by them unconsciously. For instance, if you're not really paying attention, if you're really hungry for that car, you're going to try to find a way to get it. You might do all kinds of things that are hurtful to other people and yourself just to satisfy that desire. So those desires, it doesn't even matter what the desire is for. And when Buddha came out of the jungle, he basically said, yo, monks, stuff sucks. Never going to make you happy, no matter how much you get. The dissatisfaction is the quality of this world. Nothing in the external can ever make us happy for more than a minute or two or three, depending on how good you are. So, and then begin to see how we crave pleasure and try to avoid pain. And the more we're aware of that, we see, well, they both exist, pleasure and pain. And if we keep looking, we see, well, neither one really lasts forever. So it's just a question of seeing things as they are. That's the real surrender. And when we say surrender, we're not talking to surrender to somebody else telling you what to do. But surrender to dealing with reality as it is. Because if, like Robert Swoboda says, if you don't deal with reality, it deals with you. So, when Maharaji looked at me and said, you have to go back to America. You have attachment there. What is he talking about? Attachment? I gave everything away. I gave my jeans away. I sold my guitar, my car. Gave my holy books away. I think I probably had one small cardboard box in my mother's basement, but I was never going back to America. That's when I went to India. That's where I felt. Of course, I didn't tell my mother. But in my mind, I was never going back. And then all of a sudden, after 2.5 years, you have to go. I said, Baba, I'm just learning Hindi. Too bad. And I didn't know what he was talking about. Now I know. There was so much stuff stuck in me. Nothing was flowing. Because I was avoiding every desire I had. I was clamping down. I was shutting off. I wasn't letting myself feel anything. I was really locked up. I was walking around like a robot. And what he was talking about, he was pointing out every single thing that's happened to me from that moment to this moment is what he was talking about. Those are the uncooked seeds just sitting there. And if I had stayed in India, first of all, I would have died a long time ago. I was really sick. I had so many different things going on. Hepatitis, amoeba, dysentery, everything, you know. All the good stuff. So he sent me back. And so the last time I saw him, I'm sitting in front of him, and I'm, as soon as I get up and leave, I'm going to Delhi to catch the plane. I'm sitting in front of him, and I'm thinking to myself, I'm going back to America? I've been walking around in a barefoot in a red dress for 2 years. I don't think that's going to work in New York. I got to ask him what to do. Then I said to myself, what do you mean, ask him what to do? You should have faith. What's wrong with you, you miserable shit? And I said, what do you mean, miserable? I'm going back to America. I ran in front of him. I'm arguing with myself. Finally, I blurt out, Maharaji, how can I serve you in America? He looked like he bit a pickle. Because I wasn't thinking of serving in America. Tell me what to do, you know? And he, said, Seva Purushkar Nahi Hoti. Aisa Apki Chava Aisa Karo. If you ask about service, it's not service. Just do what you want. I had been celibate for 2.5 years between the ages of 23 and 26. Prime time. And I wrapped it up and I wasn't doing nothing. When he said that, I just went, because he knew what I wanted to do. And so did I. And I knew he knew, and he knew I knew he knew I knew. And I just went, my mind literally stopped. And he looked at me, and he laughed. He said, so, how will you serve me? And I thought, okay, son of a bitch. If you don't care, I don't care. And then I bowed, and I walked across the courtyard. And I did Danda Pranam, which is the full out on the floor pranam, bowing. And while I was down there, I heard my voice in my head. But it wasn't me talking. My voice said, I'll sing to you in America. And I thought, oh, well, that's good, yeah. But that wasn't my thought. But there it was, I'll sing to you in America. But it took me 21 years. Surrender is actually recognition of the way things really are. We have desires, we have all kinds of stuff. I told this before, but you know, I sang in Hong Kong some years ago. I don't know if you've ever been there, but it's a little area jam-packed with huge-sized skyscrapers. Anyway, so there's a tram that goes up the mountain, and then you can look down into Hong Kong from up above. And I looked down, and I saw these skyscrapers, the shorter ones, if they were over 10-year-old, they were being knocked down and bigger ones were being built. The sky was full of helicopters and planes. The harbor was full of big boats, little boats, medium boats. People were rushing around. I literally said to myself, how did this happen? All you have to do is eat, sleep, drink, and fuck and shit, and you can do that under a tree. How did this happen? And then I realized, oh, people don't know how to be happy. People don't know how to access that joy in our own hearts. So we keep going for more and more and more and more and more. It was unbelievable. Somebody said that little apartment in that building on the side of the mountain goes for $500 million. It was insane. And it is insane, actually. It's the actual expression of the way this world is insane. There's never enough. Never enough. It's never enough. My father used to say, enough is too much. But that was his problem. But yeah, my goodness, you know, really, just the idea that the things we need and have to do, we can do under a tree. Where did all this come from? It's amazing. Maharaji had nothing. He had a blanket, which he used to drop every once in a while. He had a little cloth he wore around his waist. He'd go from one place to the other. They'd give him a new blanket and a new cloth, and then he'd go somewhere else. He didn't own the temples. Some of the Westerners had money. They tried to give him money. He wouldn't take it. He said, all the money in the world is mine, even the money in America. Well, who's talking there? I mean, he means that. It's another level. And the overriding feeling with him was being loved in a way you could never even imagine being loved. In your wildest dreams, just the way you know it should be, but probably never will be, that's the way it is. And the only problem was our minds. We would think ourselves right out of it. And then we'd be sitting there all depressed, feeling all cut off, and you get hit in the heart with a banana, you know? And you look up, he's gone, huh? And you're back. You know, that would happen every day. Say what?
Did you know that immediately when you first met him?
I first met him the minute I met Ramdas. When I walked into the room where Ramdas was sitting, I went up to meet him up in New Hampshire. I heard about him from a friend. I walked into the room, and he was sitting on the floor on the other side of the room, leaning against the wall, his eyes were closed, kind of meditating or something. I walked into the room without eye contact, without a word being spoken. The second I walked into that room, I knew that whatever it was I was looking for was real. It existed in the world, and you could find it. And that was the beginning of the rest of my life. There were a couple of beginnings after that. But that was the beginning of the beginning. The beginning of the beginning. And that was Maharaji. And then when I first met Maharaji, after a year and a half or 2 years, I went to India, which was a story in itself. But when I walked into the room where he was, it was confusing because I'd felt him everywhere. He was like the air that I breathed. He was the sky in which everything existed. And now there's this thing and wrapped up in a blanket. How does it all fit in there? And I was like, but I got over that. and yeah. So yeah, back there. You got the mic?
So I'm Buddhist and I'm Eastern European. I'm from Ukraine. And what I always liked about Buddhism, especially when I was just getting into it, is that it's quite inclusive or rather welcoming, meaning it doesn't require you to know a lot about the social and cultural context around Buddhism, especially in the early stage. But when it comes to Vedic teachings, right, it's like a completely different universe.
When it comes to?
Vedic teachings, right?
Vedic teachings, oh yeah, okay.
So it's like a completely different universe. have to learn like a lot. Like monkeys are flying, so on and so forth. So do you think there are some kind of barriers for Western people to get into like Vedic teachings? And do you have any recommendations how to overcome it?
I can't even spell Veda.
Neither do I.
Yeah, okay. Good. We're doing right. What's important is to learn to be able to get out of bed in the morning without wanting to kill yourself. You know? And you don't have to learn the Vedas for that. It's like Indian music is a Veda. And it's a lifelong... I don't have time to learn how to music. I'm too busy singing. If some people like to study, they like intellectual practices, so to speak. As my grandfather used to say, God bless him. He didn't mean it. But no, this not, you know, it's not necessary as far as I'm concerned. Maharaji didn't ever encourage that. He said, in fact, he said, it's better to love everybody than try to figure it out. And that's not easy, is it? So, but if one is drawn to the Vedas, I mean, because they're extraordinary, and the Upanishads, and the Smritis, and the Shrutis, and all that stuff, great. I don't even know, I don't know Sanskrit. I know the few mantras, the names that I sing. That's pretty much it. And it's more than enough for me. More than enough. And in fact, if I could say one of those names fully, even once, that would be way more than enough. So, you know what I'm saying? Where are you from?
From
Ukraine.
Ukraine?
Yeah. I sang there twice. In Kiev, and then, you know, once they had a big gathering, like a spiritual festival, thousands of people, and they zoomed me in, and I waved to everybody, and I, hey, okay. They're very sweet people. I loved it there. The mic.
How much do you practice chanting every day? You know, I'll just speak for myself. Just the past 2 days, trying to chant with you for 1.5-2 hours, I can't even do that.
Neither can I.
Liar.
Talk about trust. I sing as much as I feel like it. I'm not going to beat myself up with it, or for it, or about it. Sometimes there's just a really good serial killer movie on TV and you have to watch it. And there's no time to chant.
Desires.
Huh?
Desires.
Yeah, sure. Love it.
So Krishna does trust and love. I personally have a lot of struggle with it. If I don't trust myself, if I don't love myself, I cannot bring it to the table and love others. Default mode goes back to doubt, fear, and rumination of the past or worrying too much about the future. In theory, I get it, but in practicality, it's not there. How can I keep working on it to switch it from the default mode to the mode of love and trust.
You could turn your phone off for a change.
Not mine.
I'm kidding. How about not thinking about yourself all the time? How would that work?
I try not to, but every time I wake up or I'm going to bed, or I just find myself in that. Oh.
Yeah. Being aware that you're thinking about yourself is different than just thinking about yourself. Isn't it? Noticing what you're doing is already stepped back a little bit from it. The thoughts will come, and we immediately, we're glued to them by karmic glue. And it's only through practice and exposure to what you call the Dharma, that glue is going to get thinned out. So you sit around worrying all day, there's no time for any practice, and so nothing's going to happen. This is the way your life's going to be. And if that's the way you want it to be, okay, then you might as well be happy with it. But since you can't, maybe you should do something about it. Which means you have to develop different habits. All of us have the habit of believing everything we think. Every day, all day, we believe every single thing we think. Why? Because we're crazy, that's why. It's the definition of insanity. So you notice, you sit down and you become aware of your breath. And then you notice you've been thinking. You're no longer thinking when you notice you're thinking. At that moment, you bring your awareness back to the breath. And then you notice you've been daydreaming. When you notice, you're no longer daydreaming. So at that moment, you come back, bring your awareness back to the breath. And do that for a few minutes every day. And then get up and be stupid the rest of the day and don't think about it. That few minutes will, little by little, get a little longer. And you'll start to spend less time in dreamland. But it's a question of making some effort. You know, I was in the jungle with this Baba in the mid-80s. He was 163 years old. He really was. One day he looked at me and he said, "Oh, you're from America." Yeah, I said, "You remember when Lincoln was shot?" He said, "Oh, yeah, you wouldn't remember. We read about it in the papers," he said. So he really was 163. He left the body in his mid-180s. But anyway, so one day he was looking at me and he goes, "Ah, you're going to be famous." So I looked up at him and I said, "And rich." He laughed. I took my shot, right? Why not? If he could make me famous, he could make me rich. I don't care. What the hell? But anyway, another time I was sitting with him, and he looked at me, and he made a face, like he saw something weird. And he said, "You have to develop willpower." And then I thought to myself, willpower? What do I need that for? And then he made another face. And then he did something inside me. He showed me inside me what he was seeing in me. And then I made a face. And I saw that I wasn't doing anything. I wasn't going after the things I wanted in life. I was just floating. I wasn't living. I was just barely, and I saw it was crazy, and I wasn't, and I saw there wasn't like spiritual life and worldly life. There was just my stupid little life, and I wasn't living it. It was a big moment. It really was a big moment. And I thought, will, you want the ice cream, okay? So it's your will, the desire, and then it's your will that picks up your arm, opens the freezer, grabs the ice cream, and throws it in your mouth. So you have the desire, but I wasn't going after the things I wanted. And he could see that. And one of the things I wanted was to find Maharaji again, find that presence again. And I wasn't doing it. I wasn't using my will. And it was a really big moment. And in some ways, it led very directly to singing with people again. Ramana Maharshi said, asking the mind or the ego to kill the ego is like asking the thief to be the policeman. There'll be a lot of investigation, but no arrest will ever be made. So, we're human, we have desires, we want things. Who told us we can't have the things we want? What program is running that prevents us from living fully and going after what we want in life? It was really clear to me that if I didn't get it together on the physical plane, that so-called spiritually, it would never come together either. It was not too long. There was just me here. It was a really big moment for me. I wasn't honoring the longing I had, the deep longing I had to live in that presence of love. I was afraid of it. I wasn't honoring it. I wasn't allowing it to direct me and to move me. But that longing is what it on one hand it saves our lives, and on the other hand it ruins our lives. Because if we have that longing, nothing will ever be enough. And it's true, nothing will ever be enough. And that's the good news. We have to find it. And the good news is we can find it because it's already within us. We just have to uncover it. We keep on piling loads of shit on top of it. Every thought, every emotion, every this, every that. We just keep piling more shit on top of it. But we wouldn't be here if we didn't have the karmas to bring us here. And if we have the karmas to be interested in this stuff, that's good. It doesn't mean it's easy. Mr. Tiwari, my Indian father, who I called Baba, who has been with Maharaji for 40 years. He was a great yogi. He would look at me and he'll go, "My boy, is there something wrong with your brain?" And I said that to him many times because he would explain things to me. He knew everything, this guy. And he would tell me, I would bring him my shit and he would explain it to me. He would show me what it was, what I was doing. What. And then when I would look like I didn't understand a word, he would say, you know, he would say, my boy, is there something wrong with your brain? There is something wrong with our brains. And so we have to kind of motivate ourselves a little bit to remember to try to wake up once in a while, to try to pay attention, to try to be where we are. Before I went to India, we were up at the Lama Foundation in New Mexico for the winter, Ram Dass and maybe 10 or 15 people. And while we were there, we heard about this New York artist named Herman, who had gone to India and learned how to meditate. This was 1968, 69. Someone learned how to meditate? Wow. So a group of us went down to visit him. We spent the afternoon with him. I was kind of sitting in the back of the room, and other people were talking. I was just listening. So I was actually the last one out the door. So as I'm walking through the door, he grabbed my arm. And he looks at me and says, you have to find out why it is you can't give yourself 100% to whatever you're doing. You ever see a squirrel on the taxidermy shop, you know, nailed to the wall? How did he know? This was the thing that drove me crazy. No matter what I was doing, I wouldn't let myself get into it. I was always holding back, thinking, judging, you know, just like completely neurotically insane, stupid. And it was driving me out of my mind. How did he know that? And then some years later, I'm in India, and I'm walking around the lake in this village, town that I was in. We'd met Maharaji, seen him a few times, but mostly he told us, come back in 3 days, come back in 4 days. So we were spending a lot of time in Nainital in this town. So one night, I was walking around the lake, and at one end of the lake, there's an ancient temple, a Devi temple, actually. And as I was walking by, I heard this chanting from inside. I just stopped. I couldn't move. I was paralyzed. I was completely entranced. I just was like, what is that? What is that? They were just wailing. It was unbelievable. And some guy was going into the temple, and he saw me stand there, and he looked at me, and he laughs, and he grabs my arm, and he drags me into the temple. And so now I'm sitting on the floor with all these guys, like, and they're all singing and chanting and drums and banging. And I didn't know what was going on. And they were saying, come on, sing, sing. What? Sing what? I couldn't understand a word they were saying. But I knew. I remember, I can do this. I can do this. It turns out, I realized much later, they were singing Hanuman Chalisa. They were singing it was a Tuesday, and they were singing Hanuman Chalisa. I didn't realize that for many years, but then I went, right. Because they were singing this one, Bajaloji Hanuman, singing between every line, which is something that you can do. So you just have to, you know, those moments happen. But if you're not paying attention, if you're not in touch with that longing to get, to be in that love, to taste it, to live with it, to free ourselves from all the nonsense, all the stuff we tell ourselves, the programs that are running, all the stories we believe about ourselves, none of it is true. None of it is true. Not one thought is true. But we believe it. So that's just a bad habit, actually. And so we have to cultivate good habits. And the best habit is letting go. So you watch your breath. You say, Sri Ram, Jai Ram. And when you notice you haven't been paying attention, you come back to the Sri Ram, Jai Ram. That's all you have to do. You don't have to imagine anything. You don't have to make anything happen. You just have to come back because it's all there. But we can't stay there because the will won't hold us there. We can't hold it. And so the next thought comes around like a hawk and drags us away until it drops us, and then we're back. And then another one drags us away and we're back. But practice is really important. Of course, you can't say that around Bob. And then he says, practice, practice. When are you going to actually do the performance? He's always right on stage doing the thing. He's so great. Yeah.
Experience and then a high, and then you have to come back.
So what is that? What's high?
Like if you take some sort of drug,
yeah,
and it's a high,
mm-hmm,
and you have a real experience, but you're going to have to come back.
Mm-hmm.
I find it's the same with practices.
Uh-huh.
And I think what you just said is, you know, when is it just going to surrender into love? Like,
mm-hmm. You can't surrender with your own will.
Right.
Surrender happens, unfortunately, and fortunately, by grace. But we have to open to grace. For instance, Maharaj used to say to us, used to tease us. He said, I have the keys to the mind. I could turn your minds against me. Can you imagine you're there, wake up in India, you go, what am I doing in India? I'm going to go home. And you just completely forget about him because he just made you forget him. So we say, Baba, don't do that. And he would just laugh. Ha, you know, he loved it. But he did have the keys to the mind. And he would transfer us. And we did get transferred. So many years later, I said to Siddhi Ma, who was his great, great disciple, I said, Ma, Maharaji said he had the keys to the mind. So, to me, that means, because he's my guru, that means that I am where he put me, right? So, is it all his doing, or is my effort required? All right, the famous question, grace or effort, right? So she gave the best answer in the world. She said, Krishna Das, it's all grace. But you have to act like it isn't. So, every time you come back, it's different. It may feel the same, but the neural pathway in the brain is deepened. They've proven that. And so the more you come back, what happens is you're getting more familiar with being back, even if it's just a billionth of a millisecond longer. It is. So it's not just like a drug, because any external agent that you use is different than your own action, which comes out of your own desire to be free or to be in the space. It's very different. You're changed by it. Every time you come back, you change. So it's not exactly like an in and out kind of thing. But the problem is, or the situation is, that we are the last people in the universe in a position to judge where we are at. So That's also discursive thought. That's a program too. So when you notice yourself thinking like that, trying to kind of feel where things are at, how am I now, that's essentially just more stuff. So you just let it go and keep doing, because that's the only way it deepens. And the understandings come from inside. It's like, you go, okay. Whatever it is, it's, oh, right. And then you forget. But the moment you saw something, then you're different. That's in there too. It's not, we don't have to be on top of this. This is a driverless car, you know. We're not running the show here, but we're just paying attention. We're just coming back again and again. So whatever practice you do, essentially, they're all pretty much the same. Ultimately, one of the quotes on the napkin holder in the dining room. It was the Dalai Lama saying, you know, just because a person takes a different path than you're on doesn't mean you're not going to the same place. Something like that. So, but you know, we live in this, like, our emotional atmosphere is so familiar to us that we don't even notice how colored it is, you know, and we carry it around with us. And it's always there telling us we're fucked up, we're not enough, it'll never work, it's not going to be this, never mind, I'll do something else. We don't see it, but we're being talked to by our own stuff. And it's just, every time you come back and quiet your mind for a second, it's another seed that's planted. So don't give up. That's the one thing. Don't give up. It might turn out that everything's going to be okay. Who knew? Because the okay is not out there. Whatever's going on out there is going on out there. It doesn't have to dictate to us how we live in our own hearts. And when we're at peace with ourselves, we can be present with whatever's going on in a good way. And we can be available for other people. We can be available for ourselves even. He said, through the repetition of the name, everything is accomplished. See ya. What more is there to talk about? You know, he said that. But do we believe it? No. To the extent that we believe, that we really believe that there's a way through this, that's how far through it we are. I mean, if we really believe these practices work, whoa, the way we go through our day would be very different. And to the extent that we do believe that, that's how different our days are, no more, no less. So it's that trust. Do we trust the process? Do we trust the words of the great beings? Only to a certain extent. We're not. In the old days, somebody would come to Buddha and he'd ask to be a monk, and Buddha would say, you're a monk. And the guy would be enlightened, you know, just boom, you know, now later. Different world. The difference between Buddhism and Hinduism is really very simple. When a car breaks down, the Hindus sit down, offer some fruit, say some mantras, and ring a bell, and the car works. When the Buddhist car breaks down, they open the manual, it says just what's wrong with the car, they press a button, the car goes. That's the difference. One way says, this is how the thing works, and the other one says, this is how we get it going. It's the same. The result is the same. I just saw twice this week on Facebook. I wonder if it was AI, because I'd never seen it before. The Dalai Lama was talking to people, and he said, he was giving a lecture to, seems to India, and he said, Hinduism and Buddhism are like brothers, very close, very close, want the same thing. And this thing about self, no self, don't worry, it's a personal thing, no problem. Because that's the anatma and atma, that's supposed to be a big difference between Hinduism and Buddhism. Buddhism says there's no permanent self. There's no thing that's a self that's permanent. And supposedly, the Hindus think that the soul, with a capital S, self, is permanent. But it's not like that. It's really not like that. It's a misunderstanding. And essentially, it's just a different path to the same place. Anybody? Yeah.
Hey, Katie. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for the refrigerator.
You're welcome. Bring another one if you want.
Okay.
Next birthday.
Next life, yeah.
Speaking of different paths to the same place, my friend Tom recently sent me a cover you did of Pancho and Lefty, Tom's Van Zandt. What kind of music, moved you prior to the big acid trip before the basketball game? What music?
Well, I started out when I was growing up, folk music was a big thing. And then the folk people discovered the old blues guys from the South. And when I heard that, the country blues, from the old guys, it was like, oh, it was real, So I was really into the blues most of my life. And I'm still a blues singer, right? It just sounds a little different, that's all. Yeah, the music I'm drawn to is the music that expresses longing. Unfulfilled longing, because I'm a depressed guy, That's what I like. I like suffering. Yeah. The more, the better. Just for me, I don't want to see anybody else suffer. But I like it.
Curious a way you would describe your relationship between grief and your singing, because it took you 21 years to expand and share more of that, and then say when Ram left his body, it was a different experience, of course, different relationships with Maharaji, but what that journey and transformation with grieving people in your life has been like with the sound holding you along the way?
You know, basically, I'm a sucker for suffering and grief. And I'm very emotional. I miss every one of my friends who have gone. But they're also still here because the love is here. And that's, the grief is normal and the grief kind of passes over time. But as that mist of grief kind of just melts away, you know, the love is revealed again and the connection is still there. So in the old days in Maharaj's temple in Vrindavan, there were different shifts of groups that sang Hare Krishna. He had Hare Krishna sung in every temple he was in. And all day, different shifts. So the day shift with these widows who used to come from the widow's ashram, but the night shift from like 11 to 4, something like that, or 10 to 4 in the morning, was this young man and his daughter. She was maybe 10 or 12. And he sang and played the harmonium, and she played the drum. She just went like bong, 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 bong all night long, right? And this melody that they sang was so haunting. He was Nepali, and it was kind of a Nepali melody. And we used to hear it. We used to sit with Maharaji in the dark sometimes at night, and their voices would fill the air. And there's even a secret tape that was made of Maharaji talking. And in the background, you can hear the guy hid the microphone under his beard because Maharaji wouldn't allow it, right? So he hid the mic under his beard. And you can hear them singing in the background. It's so beautiful. Maybe I'll sing it tonight, maybe, if I can, if it shows up. So one time I was saying to Ram Dass, oh, because I heard that after Maharaji left the body, that guy was recruited from the biggest temple in Vrindavan to sing there. And the only reason he was still at the temple was because Maharaji loved him and he loved Maharaji. So, but the minute Maharaji was gone, they brought him over there and he made big bucks. And he died very young. And his daughter, I heard, married a drummer. And she died very young. So I was telling this to Ram Dass, how sad it was, you know. And he just said, but their song is still here. So it's kind of like that. They're here in that chant, in that melody. I can't tell you that story. Yeah. Are the kids still in the room? Huh? Where are they? They're sleeping. Oh, good. I can tell you the story. Remember, you asked for it. So, Ram Dass and I had not been very close for quite a few years. For good reason. We both hated each other. So. But after the stroke, I went to visit him in California. But before I went, I had recorded just a rough recording on a cassette. Remember cassettes? From Jiva Mukti, where I had started chanting. So I sent them a cassette and I, you know, said, you know, listen, this is what I'm doing these days. So I went out to California to visit with him for the first time after the stroke. And we had a great time. We had a wonderful time together. Really fun. It was great. So as we were leaving, we're going to the door, and I said, oh, by the way, did you listen to that cassette I sent you? And he said, yes. He could hardly talk at the time. You know, it's from the aphasia, from the stroke. He said, yes, yes. You're singing with much confidence now. Before you sang with I said, my dick. yeah. So, I don't know why that came to mind, but it was a real change, you know, in just, you know, I don't know if you read my book, but the story is in there much more detail, but I started singing with people in 1994, in the summer, I think. By the spring of 1995, I quit. I stopped. I quit singing with people because I saw I could not do it from the right place. I started to sing with people to save my ass, to help me find Maharaji's hand again, because I had let go of his hand. And I saw what was happening. I saw what was going to happen. I saw all the attention coming towards me, all the energy towards me, everything. And I saw I was going to use it all to satisfy my own hungry desires. And that wasn't why I did this, why I was doing it. And not only would that be bad for me, it would be bad for the people that I would use to satisfy myself with. And not only that, it wasn't going to get me what I wanted, which is I wanted to find his hand again. And so I just quit. And I went to India. And I started talking to him. I said, come on, you have to fix this. I'm singing to people in your name. This is your problem. You have to fix it. Because I was the problem, you see. And how do I fix me? It's not going to happen. And so every day I wake up, you haven't done anything. What's the problem here? You understand, I'm not singing until you fix this. Get it together. At night before I go to sleep, I said, I hope you're paying attention. You understand what's going on here. So for 3 months, this went on. And the despair was unbelievable. Because I was being prevented from doing the only thing that could help me by me. There was no getting around that. And the despair was unbelievable. And besides the fact it was 120 fucking degrees, there was no air conditioning. I was down in Lucknow with the Tiwaris, and I was out on a rickshaw with Mrs. Tiwari in the middle of the day taking her to doctors. And this, it was horrific, and it was unbearable. So then at some point, me and Mr. and Mrs. Tiwari, we moved up to their little place in the hills where it was cooler. And we went to see Sidi Ma, who was at Kenchi. And one day she looked at me, and it's like the beginning of May now, something like that. And she looked at me and said, well, what's your program? What are you doing? I said, well, you know, I guess I should be back in America by the end of May or something like that. And she was quiet for a minute. She said, no, you have to stay until June 15th, which is the day a big celebration at the temple in Kenchi, Maharaj's temple. It's the day that the first temple was opened, the Hanuman temple was opened the first time on June 15th. So every year there's a big celebration. 50, 60, 70,000 people come and everybody's fed. It's unbelievable. So I made some calls back to the States. Nobody was looking for me. So the next day, I said to her, yeah, I can stay. And so then a couple of weeks later, I moved into the temple. And in the old days, when I was living in the temple, there was one bare light bulb in the courtyard in front. That was it. There was no electricity anywhere else in the temple. You read by candlelight or a kerosene lamp or something. One bit. Now there's floodlights and everything. There's lights everywhere. You can't even find it. There was one dark corner I could find because I used to go out in the old days and lie on the roof at night. And you could see the shooting star. You could hear the shooting stars. They go like that. It was, oh, it was amazing. The Himalayas, you know. But now, but I used to find this one corner in the back of the temple where there was like a shadow and kind of no light. And I would look up at the stars and I'd say, what are you doing? You know, I'm leaving in a week. You haven't done anything yet. Don't you understand? I told you, I'm not singing to people until you fix this. Good night. I go to bed, wake up with nothing. Nothing was happening. It was terrible. I was in terrible, terrible pain and despair. It was just almost unbearable. Because I knew that the chanting was the only thing that could save me. And I couldn't do it. I couldn't do it. So, the night before the 15th, I'm leaving like on the 16th. The night before the 15th, I'm out there again, ranting and raving at him. What? I don't understand. What are you doing? You could do this if you want to. I don't understand why you're not doing it. All right, I can't make you do it if you're not going to do it. All right, I'll go back. I'll sing. How bad could it be? Good night. My friends, that is what we in New York we call surrender. That's surrender. I was pushed to my limit. I did everything I could to change the situation. I was helplessly, hopelessly help. I couldn't do a shit. And I finally gave up because I knew he could do it, but he wasn't doing it. I couldn't make him do it. All right, I'll go back. I'll sing. How bad could it be? Could have been bad. And the next day, my whole life changed. Everything changed the next day. He brought me into a space where I don't even know how to say it. It's not like I understood everything, but I saw and my perspective shifted completely. And I felt this vast space, this vast presence, outside of which there could be nothing. This space held everything in the universe inside it. people were walking around, this and that, but there was no movement in the universe. There was no sound. There was perfect peace. And at one point, I looked up in the sky, and I saw this, like, little stuff whirling around, a little circle of stuff whirling around, around, way up in the sky. And I laughed. I said, ha, that's Krishna Dasness. And it was thoughts. It was thoughts. I wasn't thinking then. And I saw, when I think I am Krishna Das, I think I'm Krishna Das. And I act like Krishna Das. But when I don't think it, and then Siddhi Ma called me, and she knew exactly what I was experiencing. She just looked at me and laughed and grabbed me and hugged me. And she said, because I was leaving that day, she said, can't you stay? And I said, no, Ma, I can't. Oh, that's too bad. I said, yes, I have to go. It was just a game. It was a play. And we both knew it. We were looking in each other's eyes. And then she said, okay, wait one second. Bring him that thing from Maharaji's room. So we just stood there, and they brought me this thing. Okay, thank you. And wait, get him that cloth that we used to wear, you know, okay. And then that was that. I walked out of the temple, I got in the car, we drove out of the valley, and nothing was moving. That was a great blessing. And I could taste that. For 9 months, it had a half-life. Every day was a little less, until about 9 months later, oh, it's a memory now. But for 9 months, so that's how I know. I mean, that's all I know. I couldn't fix a car, but that much I can tell you, that practice will open us up to the way things really are. And will allow us to really be ourselves fully. Not who we think we are, but who we really are. As we are, all the time. Never changes. Inside, we are that space that everything else is inside. We are bigger than the sky. We hold the sky inside of us. But we think we are who we think we are. So we're fucked. What to do? Chant. Which we will do later. So for now,